Hi, Kalahari lovers and subscribers of Joe's Camera. Just a quick snippet of information. Make sure those guys that are on their way to Twee Rivieren that you take care, because there's a lot of potholes on the road between Askham and Twee Rivieren, and I've seen two vehicles roll in November with trailers on. So please take care. They're not that big, but they could damage your tire or cause your tire to burst. Then there's a snippet of information about rain. The Kgalagadi had some good rains while I was here, and in the week, 20 millimeters average all the way from Askham up to Nosa Rivieren average. It fluctuated just above and just below 20 millimeters. Then there's some information about the water holes that are closed. People that are upset that the water holes are actually dry most of the time, they say, and about half of them dry apparently from halfway to Nosop. We addressed that quickly, and then also the sightings. There's been some good sightings. There's a lot of debate about sightings, a very subjective matter, whether the sightings are good or whether it should be good or not good. We addressed that very quickly in this video, so just a quick video for those that go into December, address a few issues, and please make sure to subscribe if you haven't subscribed and ring that bell. With regards to the water in the park, it is important to realize that for millennia there's been no surface water in the Kgalagadi, and all the animals and the plants that are in this area have survived because it has adapted to actually utilize the few drops of water or the moist as much as possible to survive, and therefore the Kgalagadi has provided a habitat for even predators like lion to survive. Only during the past 90 to 100 years have animals learned that there's a permanent water in the water holes that are provided by boreholes that were sunken in the early 1900s. These animals got used to the water holes, and the animal counts increased prolifically because of the surface water that are there to drink any time of the year. These animals are used to drink only when there is rainfall and there is certain conditions that assist them in providing some water a couple of weeks after the rain has fell. For instance, the tsamma would be eaten by rodents, and it will leave a hole, and in the dunes when the rain comes it will fill up with water, and it will still be present for weeks to come after the rain for small rodents, insects and birds to actually survive. Then there are conditions like the animals that have dust baths in the center of the riverbed, especially the ostrich. It will dust bath in exactly the same holes, and it will work those holes out to get quite deep. So those holes in turn in the rainy season would gather water and actually store the water for longer than any other place along the river when it dries up. The tsamma and the gemsbok komkommer are two fruits that grow in the dunes that are 95% water, and that sustain not only the animals, including lion, hyena and jackal, but the bushmen. The ancient bushmen used to survive mainly because of the tsamma that had a 90% water content. Antelope has, for instance, adapted in that they would graze mostly in the evenings and the early mornings where the relative humidity are at its highest, and it will get a lot of moisture on the plants while it's actually eating. Lion used to live off the blood and the moist of all their prey animals, so when they catch a gemsbok they would lick up the blood and the other waters of the gemsbok, and also due to the high moist content in the meat of the prey animals itself. The problem that exists today is the fact that the water table underneath the ancient riverbeds and in the adjacent areas are drying up dramatically. A lot of water holes are being reported not having water in, especially up in the upper half of the Nosop riverbed, and a lot of tourists gets upset because the water holes are empty and the animals are standing around waiting for water, especially the blue wildebeest that are very dependent on water, and especially sweet water, not the mineral rich water that the other antelope prefer. On the other hand, we have conservation. That is a policy that the animals in the Kgalagadi need to survive as much as possible without man-made water holes, as in the past. That has caused the animal counts or the animal numbers to actually decline, and animals to leave the park out the area that's not been fenced. And with the lower antelope numbers, the predators will follow and those numbers will also drop. I have no doubt that for the first time in the history of the Kgalagadi Transfrontier Park, and since it's been fenced and protected, that the lion count is actually dropping instead of increasing. To sustain the numbers of tourists that the park is creating for, and tourists along the edges of the Kgalagadi Transfrontier Park, there will have to be surface water piped and sent towards this area from elsewhere. Currently, there's a water pipeline that runs from the mines in Katu and provides water to as far as Askham and recently the Rietfontein areas. So seeing that the water is in Askham, a pipeline can come from Askham towards the park and provide some water in a central area. But one must remember that that water is also not sustainable. It is mine water that's been pumped, and as soon as that water tables dry up, then this water dries up. So water is the biggest challenge. It has been the biggest challenge for this habitat, for the animals and the plants, and it will be even more so with the human population that has increased in numbers on top of these numbers that are required, that require water. Unfortunately, the beauty of the Kalahari has attracted visitors from all over the world, and I think its popularity will never stop. This in turn triggers the politicians to build more camps so that they get more taxes and more revenue from all the tourists. And with this happening, the priorities of conservation principles actually decline. So tourism has now overtaken conservation as a priority by the government. And that is the problem that we sit with in the water, and we'll sit with even bigger problems in future. It could be the killer of the park, water itself. It has been the killer of all species that are not able to survive in dry conditions, and certainly human beings are not. So on the one hand, you sit with tourists that are very emotional, and they don't like animals to stand around dry water holes. They think it's one of their pets. And on the other hand, you have conservation that believes that this area should be an arid region and animals should go back to the conditions that they were before man interfered and actually indeed erected fences and built water holes. I understand that, and I understand that there are certain decisions that need to be made by conservation people that are scientists, that knows much more about controlling the system in a sustainable way than the tourist. But I certainly don't agree on non-transparent issues. So when water is drying up and people don't talk about it, the conservation are not open and transparent about it because they want another camp and another camp to get the revenue, then, and the conservation departments within these areas are silenced, that's when a problem is starting to become a stakeholder problem. The only way we can have our finger on the pulse is I want, you know, everyone to contribute towards good decision making and sustainability of the park, the stakeholders. And the stakeholders are indeed me and you, the guys that are paying the taxes for this area to actually be protected. And I make a call that people out there actually get involved and make sure, get an informed decision of what's going on in our conservation areas like Kruger and the Kgalagadi Transfrontier Park. The challenge, however, it's a transfrontier park, the Kgalagadi, and it has two management plans, a South African management plan and a Botswana management plan, and then they should have an integrated plan that integrate operating procedures from both sides. And that's where the lack is. There's already currently a lack of control from the Botswana side in controlling and maintaining the fences, and therefore South Africa just loses. It loses out as these animals move into Botswana, and over there they are killed, they are eaten or sold, whatever is happening, and South Africa has provided that. And I think there's a stronger voice if one take the prosopis trees that are taking over on the southern side of the park, and Botswana is doing nothing to that. That's eating up into the water table directly. The very process or procedure or system that should protect us from overdevelopment in the tourism areas in our parks are the environmental impact studies, but there over the recent few or 20 years, we have found that in the environmental impact studies has just become a piece of paper that everyone can pay for under the table, and it's not really worth the ink that it's written with. That is the areas that we can get involved in, is to make sure that whenever there's development, we as stakeholders, not the small group that's been designed and developed to act as a smokescreen, but all the stakeholders indeed know what is happening with conditions such as the water in the Kgalagadi Transfrontier Park.